Good evening to everyone. I welcome you all to NVIS webinar theme, Know Your Ecosystem. And today's topic is Lichens and Their Importance by Dr. Sanjeevan Ayaka. He is currently working as Senior Principal Scientist and Professor of ACSIR at CSIR National Botanical Research Institute, Lucknow. He has about 20 years of research experience in the area of lichenology, and his area of interest includes lichen taxonomy, biogeography, and bioprospection. He has so far discovered 26 species as new to science and also reported 96 species as distributional record to India, and has authored 3 books and about 200 research papers in peer-reviewed journals. He has successfully handled a total of 35 research projects as a team member, as PI, co-PI or coordinator, and also has guided 4 students for PhD and presently guiding 6 scholars. He has traveled extensively throughout India for exploration of lichens. He has also visited Antarctica twice for studying diversity and physiology of lichens in Skrimacher Oasis. He has also trained more than 60 scholars from all over the country for identification of lichens, and also has provided technical assistance to 38 academic institutions for carrying out lichen research. And Dr. Ayaka is elected Fellow of International Society of Environmental Botanist and Mycological Society of India, and also is honored with Best Scientist Award by Nature Science Foundation, Coimbatore. So it is an immense pleasure to welcome today's speaker, Dr. Sanjeevan Ayaka, and I would like to hand over this webinar session to him. Over to you, sir.
Okay, very good evening. Thanks, Deepthi, and also thanks to all the organizers of NVIS, and especially to Dr. TVR. So I always have a high regard for Dr. TVR, because he has helped me, and there are many students like me who he has helped a lot. And sometimes I can say that he had played a very important role in my career also. So although I was associated strongly with Professor Gadgil, so sometimes he had helped me a lot. So thank you, sir. Thank you again for suggesting my name for this webinar. So my specialization is lichen taxonomy. Okay. So, but I also work on the other field. For today's webinar, I have selected a very general topic, because the kind of audience today are, as I heard, that they are graduates or just postgraduate students. So that is why I don't want to keep my talk hi-fi or purely taxonomic or something like that. So I'll talk on the general topic. Okay. So as told by Deepthi, you can put your questions in the chat box. If I could able to access that, I will read that and answer to that questions. Otherwise, Deepthi will help me. Okay. Otherwise, you can also switch on the mic and ask, but preferably at the end of the end of my presentation. And I would like to keep my presentation just 1 hour, not more than that. I would try to complete before that, so that we'll have sufficient time for the discussion. So by this time, you all know what a lichen is. Okay. So everyone knows that it's a symbiotic association between fungus and algae. Okay. So, but it's not as simple as that. It's because, see, when these fungus and an alga make an association, they undergo lots of changes. So they'll undergo morphological changes, physiological changes. So they lose their original identity and then start behaving as a single entity, single organism. That is very important. So here in this picture, what you see from outside is fungus. Where is alga here? Alga is there inside, inside the lichen thallus. Okay. You don't see them outside. When you cut a section, then only you will see. When I say alga, it is better to call them as a photobiont. Fungal part is mycobiont. Mycos means fungus. Like that, algal part or the photosynthetic partner may be called as a photobiont. Among them, when I say alga, it's usually green alga. So we fave blue green alga, but technically it should be called a cyanobacteria. Cyanobacteria, they are not alga, the bacteria group. So that is why we say mycobiont and photobiont. In photobiont, mostly they are green alga, and the another part, sometimes it is cyanobacteria. Okay, at a given time, there will be one primary fungus and there will be one primary photobiont. Okay, so they are called the primary associates. So once they form an association, it is a stable association. It usually don't get disassociated, and they are interdependent on each other for several things in the life cycle. So then recently there was a lot of hue and cry regarding the third partner associated with the lichens. You people might have read in the newspaper or in the news items, scientific news items and all. So lichen is made up of three organisms. That was a theory that was proposed based on some experiment. So what happened? So there is a group of scientists led by Sprebel. So they did some experiment on the lichens. There are lichens called Bryoria. So this is a Bryoria lichen. One species Bryoria tortuosa, another is Bryoria fermentoi. So you can see here Bryoria fermentoi is brown in color, whereas tortuosa is yellowish in color. Okay, so why these two are different species? Apart from the color, they also produce something called as ulpinic acid. See, in lichen, chemistry is very much important in taxonomy, that is called chemotaxonomy. So chemistry plays a very important role in segregating the species. So this Bryoria tortuosa produces ulpinic acid, so that is why it is yellow in color, whereas Bryoria fermentoi doesn't produce ulpinic acid, that is why it is brown in color also. So this group, they doubted that this should be belong to same species except for the chemistry. So they did molecular phylogeny and all. They found they are genetically same, okay, but phenotypically they are different. So then they looked into why it is producing ulpinic acid, why one is not producing ulpinic acid. They did transcriptome analysis and all. They did not find anything conclusive. So then what they did, they tried to see the genome of these both the lichens. Then they could see in one of the lichen about 500 contigs of genes of Basidiomycetes fungi were also there. Otherwise, these lichen belong to group Ascomycetes fungi, but they could get lots of Basidiomycetes genes also in this particular lichen, tortuosa, and it was there in fermentoi also, but it was less. So then when they analyzed that Basidiomycetes genes, so they found it belong to yeast, Cyphoblastidium yeast, okay. So that is why they then did some fish hybridized technique they used. They could here also you can see fluorescent greenish dots here. They are the yeast, okay. Here again, it's abundant here it is less. Then it was clear because of this yeast, it is producing ulpinic acid. Otherwise, these two are same. Okay, now they wanted to see whether this yeast is present in only this lichen or other lichens also. Then they collected lichens from several places, almost from six continents. They analyzed. They found that almost all the lichens which they analyzed, they have this kind of yeast. And this is how you see it is the scanning electron microscope picture. See the outermost layer here, the greenish, it is the yeast layer. And the bluish one, what you see, it is the fungal part of the primary symbiont in the lichen, and the reddish one is the autofluorescence of the photobiont of the algal cells. So this is what they produce. They could see, and then they proposed now the lichens are not made up of two organisms; they are made up of three organisms. This is what they claimed, and they published, and that is it becomes a big news. And even I also gave some people contacted me also. I also responded to their queries. It appeared in the paper and all. Later on, the research in this direction went on, and there several evidences are produced. But people could see the presence of Basidiomycetes yeast is very, it's not consistent. It's present in only some lichens, and it's not always present. So that is why the claim of three organism in the thallus, lichen thallus formation is ruled out, or it is still under criticism. It is not yet accepted. Okay. Now, in lichens, the Basidiomycetes yeast is not only the other associate. So it has several other organisms in close association. One fungus and one photobiont, this is fixed. There are primary symbionts. Apart from that, like yeast, there are many other fungus also may be associated with the lichens. Okay. Then here you can see there will be one alga and fungus will be there. Sometimes the cyanobacteria also make an association in the lichen, that is tripartite lichens. So cyanobacteria also make an association along with the two partners. So here you can see in this last picture. So here the black dots, what you see, that is the secondary fungi which is parasitizing on the lichens. Like that, you know, these endophytes are the fungus which are present inside the lichen. Like here, endolichenic fungi are also there. Fungi which resides inside the lichen. Lichen is already a fungus. Inside there will be another fungus. So that is endolichenic fungi. So this is how when you cut a lichen section, you will see major portion is of fungus and the smaller portion is of algal cells here. Okay. So now the lichen has, apart from two basic partners, there are many other organisms are involved. That is why nowadays we call lichens as the micro ecosystem, because there are many closely interacting organisms are involved. So from the time the lichens were observed, people started studying them from Carl Linnaeus period, to till now, there are several definitions for the lichens. And latest one is, which says this lichen is a self-sustaining ecosystem formed by the interaction of exhabitant fungus, that X means outside fungus, formed by the interaction of an inhabitant, and extracellular arrangement of one or more photosynthetic partners, and indeterminate number of other microscopic organisms. This is a definition. So I mean to say here is that lichens are fungus. We identify lichens based on the fungal characters. The name which we give to the lichen is the fungal name. In other words, we call the lichens as the lichenized fungi. There are fungi which are free living. There are fungi which make a symbiotic association like mycorrhiza and all. So here the lichens are symbiotic. Fungus is in the symbiotic association with the algae here. There are different names for the lichens. It's actually lichen or lichen. Okay. So some people also pronounce it as lichen. Lichen. So it is not a correct pronunciation, but people pronounce it. It's okay. Okay. In English, it is called oak moss, island moss, reindeer moss and all. In Kannada, it's kalluhuvu. Kalluhuvu is very popular, and shilavalka sometimes people use in Kannada, but kalluhuvu is very popular. But there are many languages in Tamil, kalpasi, kaljadai, Hindi, patharkapool. So, kallu or the stone is common in most of the languages. Okay, so in Marathi it is called dagadpool. So kallu or the stone is very common in all the languages, most of the languages. In Hindi, we try to derive a technical term. It is called shaik. It's formed by the two words. Shaiwal is for algae, kavak is for fungus, and we have taken initial first letter to make the word shite, like that. So there are many unique characters of lichens. They're very slow grow. I mean, they grow on all kinds of substratum, rock, moraine, soil, on the dead wood, building materials, rusted iron, bones, many of the substratum they grow. Okay. So they can grow in a harsh and hostile environment. For example, the cold deserts of Antarctica, Leh Ladakh, and hot deserts like Thar or the Sahara, they can grow here very comfortably. Okay. Of course, type of the species, what we get, there are different, but lichens can grow here. For example, rock. Rock is in hostile substratum. Rock doesn't contain any nutrient, but lichens can comfortably grow on the such a hostile substratum also. They're very slow growing. Because they're very slow growing, they require very low nutrient, and since they grow in a nutrient deprived areas, substratums, they also grow very slowly, and their metabolic rate is also slow, and that is why they are poor competitor also. So they cannot, unlike a fast growing fungus, for example, you keep a bread piece outside, today you keep, by tomorrow you can observe dense growth of fungus on this bread piece. So whereas the fungus that makes the lichen are very slow growing, they cannot compete with the other fast growing lichens. That is why they prefer such a substratum where there is no competition, where there are no other organism growing. They're pycnohydrous, means they cannot control their water balance. If the water is available in plenty, they take the water. When the harsh climatic conditions comes, they lose their water content, and they can lose up to 98% of the water. When the water again is given, it takes up the water and comes back to the life. So that such kind of plants are called resurrective plants. So lichens are resurrective fungus, or the plants are their pycnohydrous, we say. So we don't use the term plant for the lichens, because if they are fungus, fungal kingdom is completely different. Sometimes we call lichens as plant because it behaves as a plant by having algae chlorophyll content. It prepares its own carbohydrates of the food. That is why we call as a plant. So lichens remain physiologically inactive during the harsh climatic condition. They are extremely tolerant to the freezing stress. It is observed that they can withstand temperature up to -196 degrees. They have survived 96 weeks in the frozen condition at -15 degrees for 10 years. So you can, 10 years at 20 degrees, -20 degrees, you can imagine how tolerant to these freezing condition these organisms. They have lots of carbohydrates and polyols. It is speculated because of these carbohydrates polyols, they are tolerant to the freezing condition. Okay, there is no frost injuries or the cold injuries are found in the lichens. They can also photosynthesize in a low temperature as well as in the reduced light. That is why you can see sometimes the lichens growing in the caves also or under the snow. So because lichens are harsh organisms, very sturdy organisms, they have also been sent to the space for the space experiment. So in the International Space Station in Europe, in an experiment called as Lichen and Fungi Experiment, that is LIFE, in the International Station, they sent the lichens, this one, Xanthori elegans. Okay, it was exposed to 1.5 years to the stress of the low Earth orbit, including the ultraviolet radiation, cosmic radiation, and vacuum condition. So when it is brought back to the Earth after 1.5 years, 71% of the lichens remained viable. So lichens can sometimes prove as the experimental model for such an extreme experiment. Or life on the other planets can also be extrapolated. Theory can also be extrapolated using the lichens. So such an harsh organism. Little bit of history. I'll quickly browse through these slides. There are many slides. I'll quickly go through this. Of course, lichens are there in the associated with the culture of the human being from long back. But Theophrastus is a person who coined the term lichen for the superficial growth of fungus kind of thing on the olive bark. Okay, he is called it as lichen. So, but he could not define, he did not define what exactly lichens, how they look and all. So after he coined the term lichen, there are many Greek ancient authors, they popularized the term lichen, and but they used it for several organisms, both for, I mean, for also for lichen, mosses, liverworts, fungi, seaweeds, even for the corals, they referred the term lichen. Then come Joseph Tunford. He could fairly define lichens. He included mostly the lichens, but unfortunately, he also included some unrelated organisms with the term lichens. But the Jacob Delenius is a person who clearly differentiated lichens from the other group of organisms. And he gave a definition or the kind of characterization for the lichens. Then there are, of course, there are many other scientists. Then the important personality comes here, the Carl Linnaeus. You all know him as the father of modern taxonomy and all. In his monumental work, Species Plantarum, he described 80 species of lichens under one genus, lichen, in the 24th class, that is class Cryptogam. Then came the Eric Acarius. Eric Acarius, he is a student of Carl Linnaeus. By the time microscopes and all very much invented, they were used. Carl Linnaeus did not make use of the microscope, but his student Eric Acarius, he made use of the microscopes, and he described more than 3,000 species of lichens, and he coined several terminology, and he laid a strong foundation for the lichen studies. So that is why he is called as the father of lichenology. And it's very unfortunate that he died while working on the lichen under the microscope. He was observing the lichen material that was sent to him by from the Spain. He was very much frustrated because they were all novel species. He was not finding them, their characteristics and all. So because they were all almost new, so while working on the microscope itself, he had a last breath. So then came, there are several other people who are very strong lichenologists of yesteryears, maybe Nylander, Müller Agrovensis. Some of these people also studied the lichens of India. These two persons are very much important here. These two persons, simultaneously, they were working on the lichens. They had a doubt that lichens are made up of two organisms. One is from fungal part, another is the algal part. So, by that time, nobody knew lichens are made up of two organisms. Although Carl Linnaeus, Eric Acarius studied, they used to term these grimy structure as a gonidium or something like that. So, D. Berry, he strongly doubted this, the greenish part, what is seen in the gel-like lichen, this is a gel-like lichen, is the nostrum. Okay, by the time Simon Swidner, he developed the theory of dual nature, and he proposed it, and he gave a presentation in the Swiss Natural History Society's annual general meeting. So this theory became very popular. But simultaneously, Simon Swidner also faced a lot of criticism. People did not easily accept his theory. So because if you accept that lichens are made up of two organisms, then the monopoly or the that separate identity of the lichens will be lost. So that is where people argued regarding this, and they did not accept it. D. Berry derived the term, he coined the term symbiosis to define the relation between this fungus and the algal part. He simply meant symbiosis, means simply living together. He did not say what kind of relation, he simply said symbiosis, that means living together. And these are the illustrations of the Simon Swidner. So people kept on criticizing. He kept on answering the queries of the people, kept on publishing till his last breath. Okay. And then Edward Venue, he proposed that lichens are fungus, and he classified lichens under the fungal category only, fungal group only. But he faced a lot of problem. He lost his job, actually. He was working as a professor in of Department of Botany in Helsinki. He lost his job because he said lichens are parallel to fungi. So the other lichenologist, who is called Nylander, he was an influential person at that time. He fired him from the job. Then the classification job was given to Alexander Zollwegner. He was that time, he was a not that particular lichenologist. And the people, because of the terror of some influential lichenologist at that time, they did not dare to classify lichens under the fungi. They treated lichens as a separate classification unit. You can imagine the terror of science, some influential scientists, are the, what do you say, mafia, science mafia were there at that time also. Okay, it's not new nowadays. Then Zollwegner, he classified lichens into as a separate classification unit, separate entity, and he wrote about 10 volumes of catalogs of lichens of the world. So it is very popular, Zollwegner catalog it is called. So for a long time it was there, and only in 1960s or 16 or so, Rolf Santensen, he was a Swedish lichenologist, he convinced and he made a bold step in classifying the lichens under the fungus. So he was working on the follicular lichens, the lichens which grow on the leaf. So after that, now people are convinced. As a development of molecular tools and all, now people are convinced that lichens are fungus only. So Hawksworth is a modern day mycologist. Lumsch and then Liu King, Ludzoni, these were the recent times lichenologists, some of the mycologists who are convinced and also classified lichens under fungal kingdom. You can see Vijayavardhan et al. This is a very recent classification where lichens are intermingled with the other fungi. For example, Vijayavardhan's classification, if you see, under the fungal kingdom, there are 19 phyla. So under these 19 phyla, Ascomycota and the Basidiomycota has the lichens. Okay. In Ascomycota, there are 21 classes. Among them, 6 classes contains lichens here. Okay. So for example, all these 6, among these 6, Lecanoromycetes has purely lichenized fungi, only lichens here, but other classes have both lichenized and free living fungi. Here in Basidiomycota, there are 15 classes in total, 2 classes contains lichenized fungi. And the studies related to Basidiomycetes lichens are still under progress, and in coming days, there may be several species or the several, there may be dramatic change in the classification of the Basidiomycetes lichens, because they started getting clues indicating that there are more than now there are only 100 species under the Basidiomycota, Basidiomycetes lichens. There may be more than that. Studies are still and the progress using the molecular tools and other tools. Coming to the history in India, quickly, lichen study in India can be categorized into 2 groups, pre-independent and the post-independence. Like during the British time, lichens of the India or the any other group, any plant and animals of the country, they were studied by the Britishers. So like that, lichens are also studied by the Britishers, Europeans, starting from Carlinius. Carlinius included only one species from India. Erica included four species from India. You know, these people who initially collected or they studied lichens from India, they were sometimes botanists or simply they were plant collector. They were also sometimes doctors, and the doctors like physicians and the surgeons. You know, J.D. Hooker, Strachey, Wallis, Kurz, they were all botanists. And whereas Dr. Cunningham and all, he was a surgeon. And E. Fries and the Montagne, Muller Agrovensis, these are the lichenologists who studied the lichens from of the India. These people collected it and transferred the material to Fries, Montagne and other people who in turn studied them and published papers. So only in the late 1930s or the 40s, the Indians started studying the lichens of their own country. Qureshi, Kashyap, Chaudhary, Chopra, and all they were Indians. Again, in the beginning, their material was studied again by the Europeans. T.R. Seshadri, he was a very popular natural chemist. He was a South Indian. Finally, he settled at the Delhi University, and he published papers regarding the unique chemistry of the lichens. Again, his material was also identified by the Europeans only. Then the K. Biswas at the Royal Botanical Garden, which is now called as the Subhash Chandra Bose, Subhash Chandra Bose Botanical Garden in Kolkata. So he was the superintendent there. He initiated little bit of work along with the Dr. Awasthi, D.D. Awasthi. So D.D. Awasthi was a fresh MSc guy at that time. He went from the BSI as a trainee there. He was a trainee there in the BSI. And initially they wrote few abstract. There onwards, Dr. Awasthi took interest in lichens. So he become a faculty at Lucknow University in 1950s, and he could establish a lichen laboratory there. And he also got an opportunity to visit University of Colorado. And he, in fact, has two PhDs, one from India, another from Colorado University, USA. So he established a very good laboratory of lichen research in the Lucknow University. And he guided several students. So that is why he is called as the father of Indian lichenology. Okay. So I'll not go into his other credentials and all. And after some time in 1960 at NBRI, Dr. Ajay Singh started working on the lichens. And after Ajay Singh, Dr. D.K. Upriti was looking after the lichenology laboratory. And after the superannuation of Dr. Upriti, I am looking after the lichen group here in the NBRI. And meanwhile, the lichen research was also started at the Agarkar Research Institute. At that time, it was called as Maharashtra Association for Cultivation of Science. Dr. P.G. Patwardhan, he was a mycologist. He started the work, and his concentration was, his focus was towards the lichens of Andaman Nicobar Islands, Western Ghats, and sometimes in the northeastern India. So with North India and the Western Himalaya was studied by NBRI group and Lucknow University, Dr. Awasthi's group. So he discovered several species and all. After the retirement of Dr. Patwardhan, these were the people who studied Urmila Makija, Dr. Makija. He is also retired now. Now at Agarkar Research Institute, Dr. Bhaskar C. Behra and Bharti are working on lichens. And there is a sad story regarding Dr. P.G. Patwardhan. He was a dedicated lichenologist. He had developed a brain tumor while working at Agarkar Research Institute. That is why he lost one eye. Sight in the one eye he lost. And at the fag end of his retirement, he completely became blind. He lost vision, eyesight, both the eyes. So otherwise, he could have contributed even after the superannuation. And then at BSI, Botanical Survey of India, I told you, K. Biswas and the Avasthi started, but it was inactive for many years. And although Dharni, Chaudhary and all they were, they could not continue. Only after several years, in 1975, Dr. K.P. Singh, he was a senior most student of Dr. Avasthi, he joined the Botanical Survey of India and started working on the lichens. And he was there at the northeastern region. You know, this Botanical Survey of India has several centers. He was there at a Shillong center. Then he finally retired from the central region, that is Allahabad. Then Dr. G.P. Sinha was also with him for at BSI. Then he is also retired now. Now Dr. Jagdish Ram is working on lichens. Andaman Nicobar Islands Center, Andaman and Nicobar Regional Center, okay, at Port Blair. And then otherwise, lichen research was started in here and there, but they did not flourish. They did not continue. For example, at IISc Bangalore, CES also, lichen study was conducted by one of the students of Professor Madhav Gadge. So that is Hansiraj Negi. So came to IISc, I came as a JNC summer research fellow. Professor Gadgil gave me the work to study the lichens of the Western Ghats. Finally, I settled down to lichens of Bangalore city. At that time, Dr. Negi was my kind of guide. Okay, so today our collection, Dr. Negi's collection and my collection from the Bangalore city is deposited in the herbarium of the CES. Okay, so after superannuation of the of Professor Gadgil, lichen work did not continue at IISc. At KFRI also, Dr. Muktesh Kumar started. He guided one student, and Muktesh Kumar retired and work stopped. But KFRI still has the lichen herbarium. At Bharathidasan University, Professor K.V. Krishnamurthy started. He guided even a G.R. Hariharan, this fellow, and it is then stopped. But Dr. G.N. Hariharan, he is still continuing with the lichen work, Swaminathan Research Foundation. But his focus is mainly towards the bioprospecting studies. And since the lichen study in India, very few people are working, and we wanted to encourage people to work on the lichens. Also, we wanted people to bring together for the lichen study who are working on the lichen. We wanted them to come together, share their ideas, popularize lichen field. And all. That is why we established this society, Indian Lichenological Society, and we are conducting several training programs, workshops, and then conference and all through this society. And we have around 200 life members in this society, and also we have a YouTube channel for the popularizing the lichens in the country. You can just type in the YouTube Lichens of India, the Indian Lichenology. So you will go to this YouTube, and there are several videos uploaded here. You can see that. So these were the early lichenologists from the country. You can see Patavardhan and all. At present, there are about 100 plus lichen researcher working here and there in the country. So our good thing is that they were all connected to us, and we are giving them a kind of support for the carrying out the lichen research. Sometimes their students are coming to NBRI for training, and also sometimes we are going there with a technical support and other things. So now coming back to the diversity of lichens in India. In the world, actually, there are different people started giving the, they have given different figures at several instances, 22,000. But at a given time, you can round figure the number of lichens to 2,000 species. Okay. So this has become a constant number from several years. So in the world, there are 20,000 species of lichens are there, and under 40 orders, 120 families, you can say, about 1,000 genera, you can say. So where we have huge diversity of lichens, or the luxuriant growth of lichens, that is in the tropical rainforest. So it is said that sometimes you can get 600 species of lichens per hectare in a tropical rainforest. Unfortunately, these tropical rainforests are underexplored for the lichens, because these were one of the inaccessible places in the world. That is why most of the time lichens of these tropical areas are underexplored, and that holds good for India also, where we have the Western Ghats and also these northeastern states. So we have huge diversity but underexplored. So in India we have done good work. I don't say we have covered all the places. There are many places which need to be explored for the lichens. Some 40 protected areas we have studied. We, in the sense, including NBRI, our group, and all the other lichen researchers in the country. We have prepared several checklists and all. So we have 2,900 species of lichens now, which is about 14.5% of the world known lichens under the 407 genera and 79 families. And so if you see the subspecies, varieties and all, it goes up to 3,000 or 2,950, you can say, round figure. Okay. About 19%, 550 species are endemic to the country. You don't get them anywhere in the world. So these are the four regions in the country, you can say, biodiversity hotspots or the lichen diversity hotspot. That is Western Himalaya, around 1,200 species we have. In the northeastern region, including the northeastern Himalayas, there are 1,500 species, or the 1,600 species, you can say. And Western Ghats, we have around 1,500 species. Andaman Nicobar Island, although it's a small landmass, we have the huge diversity of lichens. We have around 525 species. So, as I told you, we have now 2,900 species. From 1965 onwards, we have a track of lichens species being added to the country. So, in the 1965, based on the catalog published by Avasti, there were around 960 species are present in India. So thereafter, so from 2010, Dr. K.P. Singh and G.P. Singh, they published checklist of Indian lichens. So it gave us the good idea of total number of species of lichens for the India. Thereafter, we were checking how many species we are adding every year. You can see this graph going exponential. From 2010 to 2019, we have added about 610 species of lichens to the country at an average of 61 species per year. So 90 species, about 90 new species we have discovered from the country. Okay, it is not that they were not there earlier. They were there. Only thing is that our exploration improved and we could explore some of the unexplored areas. That is why these number of species could be documented for the country. For example, here you can see there are two colors here. One is 2010 based on the Singh and Sinha's checklist of lichens for India. So which gave us the idea which are the places or the states underexplored. That is why we took up the studies in the underexplored areas, and this is the information, the data for the 2010. So Uttarakhand, earlier there were about 800 species. Now we have 1,000 plus species. At present, Uttarakhand is the highest lichen documented states. Here also it is one of the highly explored, intensively explored areas. Then comes the Tamil Nadu. Then comes this place like Arunachal Pradesh and the West Bengal. West Bengal here, it is mainly because of the Darjeeling area. Otherwise, you can see there are many areas. For example, Gujarat. Gujarat, see, earlier there were only two species known. Now we have 95 species because we took up a project in the Gujarat. I had a project from the for the Gujarat lichen studies. Like that, you will get many places like Tripura. There were no record. Now we have some record. Mizoram, there were no records. We have some good record of lichens like that. Even then, there are many places like Haryana, Delhi, Chandigarh, Punjab. there are no records of lichens at all, Diodaman or Dadar Haveli and all. So it's not that there are no lichens there. There are lichens, but place these areas are not explored for the lichens. Coming to the importance of the lichens, one very good importance of the lichens in the nature is this, the soil formation. As I told you, rock, the barren rock is a hostile substrate, and only lichens can grow there. Once the lichens start growing, lichens, they break the rock into soil particles by physical process as well as the chemical process. So, and in the chemical process, they secrete a lot of chemicals which reacts with the rock minerals, and there is a process called a chelation. Because of that process, these mineral, soil minerals are gets detached from the rock surface. And then the in the physical process, what happens, the root-like structure of the lichen as well as the lichen mycelia, sometimes they gets into the small crevices in the rock, which you cannot see, the micro crevices. So also lichens are closely, tightly, they attach to the rock. When they get moisture, they expand. When they when the moisture is removed due to the harsh condition, when the water is lost, they get contract, they get contracted. So this contraction and expansion takes place at least twice in a day. It creates a lot of pressure in the rock surface. That is how rock surface gets broken and converted into soil particles. It's a very, very slow process in the nature. You cannot visualize them, but it's a very important process in a geological scale. So that is how it makes a place suitable for the growth of the other next group of organism, that may be moss. And also sometimes moss gets replaced by the grasses and all, weeds and all. Then these grasses gets replaced by the herbaceous plants. Like that, one day you will see a climax forest. This is ecological succession. Okay, this is how lichens play a very important role in the soil formation. And that is how you might have seen lichens which are growing on the, sometimes on the monuments, beautiful sculptures like this. And there are argument that lichens can give in aesthetic importance to the, these monuments. You can also feel that, okay, these monuments are old ones. You can see lichens are growing them. But if you don't remove them, these lichens deteriorate this rock. Okay, so that is why it is better you have to remove them. And lichens are food for these. There are several invertebrates, snails, insects. They graze on the lichens. They eat the lichens. So that is why lichens act as the important food. So you can, for example, here in this slide, you can see the deer. The deer, and this is a lichen called as Cladia. It's also called as reindeer moss. It is growing like a grass and like a carpet. Okay. So in winter, when there are no other plants to eat, these deers, they dig out the snow and they eat the lichens. Okay, so that is why lichens in the winter, they play important role for these deers. Sometimes lichens are collected from the forest and also fed to the farm animals or the zoo animals. So lichens have a very good in the food chain. Okay, for example, you see this is the lichens eaten by a northern flying squirrel. And this northern flying squirrel is again eaten by the northern spotted owl. Okay, so bioaccumulation of radionucleotides in the lichen is a very good example for the linkage of lichens in the food cycle. So Chernobyl in Russia, Chernobyl accident, you may be knowing, where a lot of radionucleotides got leaked, and these radionucleotides are accumulated by the Scandinavian lichens. These lichens are eaten by the reindeers, and these reindeers are eaten by the human beings, okay, man. So finally, the bioaccumulation took place in a large quantity in the deers. So then it was declared that these deers are not palatable, are not good for consumption. So this is the food link in the food chain, you can clearly see for the lichens. And these are the several animals which eat lichens as a food, and these are this is the big list of lichens which are eaten by animals. And lichens can give a good shelter to the protozoa and insects and all. Sometimes if the thick growth of lichen is there on the tree bark, you can also expect the lizards and the snake also be hiding in the on these lichens. So lichens give a shelter to the animals. And some of the lichens which have the cyanobacteria as their photobiont, they have an ability to fix the nitrogen, and nitrogen cycle, they play an important role, and such lichens increases the fertility of the soil also. See how nicely this lichen is providing a background for the camouflage. You can see here the paper moth is sitting over the lichens here. So it is, that is how it is being safe from the predator. So here, this is called the catetid insect. It is looking like a lichen only. This is a lichen moss here. So it is a mimicry, kind of a mimicry. Here you can see, this is the praying mantis kind of insect. It is again looking like a lichens only. So when it sits on the lichens here, you cannot differentiate them. Here there is a caterpillar looking like lichens only. Here again a leaf insect is sitting over the leaf. Leaf also has a lichens white spot. Here again it is looking like a leaf only. So here the frog is nicely sitting over the lichens here, you can see. So it has taken a design of the lichens only. Here again the lichen is here, the frog is sitting over here. Like that you can see, this is a leaf-tailed gecko, okay, lizard here. So here very nicely it is camouflaged. You can see it is eyes here and its head portion here. So otherwise on the bark also lichen is there. It is also having the texture of the lichen here. You can see nicely, closely attached to the twig here. So lichens are playing small role, very important role. So like that, here this bag insect, it is having some lichens on it. When it moves over the lichens like this, leprous lichens, you cannot make out. So this is a lichen rhizocarpon. Salamanders sits over such a lichen and you cannot differentiate them. Lichens also act as a very good nesting material. You can see here the hummingbird has built its nest using completely the lichens here. Here again one nest of a bird which is completely made up of lichens. Here the lichen is used as the decorative item, as a cushion here. Here the lichens are there on the ground, and these eggs are laid along with the lichens. It's camouflaged here. Like that, here one more nest example you can see here. So other services of the lichen, like it is helpful in the photosynthesis and the carbon fixation, nutrition, nutrient cycling, denitrification, metal chelating. It also sometimes prevents the soil erosion. It regulates the air quality because it absorbs, accumulates a lot of heavy metals. Many things are there, small role it plays. And it is also, lichens are also useful to the man. So you people may be eating lichens, you may not be knowing. So when you bring a garam masala or the sambar masala from the market, their lichens may be an ingredient there. You can turn the packet and see for the ingredients. You can see sometimes the name lichen or some species of lichen name, lichen, or its stone flower. It may be written stone flower or the black stone flower. So it can be sold as raw masala like this, like we use we call this as tejpatta. And then you can see like that, you can see along with the other spice you can see here. So these are some of the branded masala where clearly lichen or the lichen name is mentioned here. This is a picture sent by my friend from south, Dr. Vinayaka. So a lot of lichens are being collected from the Western Ghats area and they're sold for the spice. Okay, this is a picture of the Udham Singh Nagar in the foothills of Himalaya, where the lichens are collected from Himalaya, they are segregated and sold. There are actually different grades of the lichens. Grade 1 lichen should have only one species, either Parmatrema nilgirensis or Euryngiostrum. Grade 2 will have two species or only, not more than two species. Grade 3 can have up to 5 species as a mixture, but the kind of spice which we get in the market, local market, are mixture of several species. Our own studies from the lichen spice from the different market had 31 species of the lichens. So there is no grade at all. Where what happens to the first grade and second grade and the third grade lichens? They are either exported to outside or they are given to the five-star hotel for making a special recipe out of it. Sometimes the recipe which are made for the made of lichens are the chef's secret. You don't know. So sometimes when you eat the restaurant food, maybe Hyderabad biryani, a lot of lichens are used in the Hyderabad biryani. So same biryani when you make at home, it doesn't smell good. So that is the because probably you didn't use the lichens as a spice. So lichen as such don't give a smell. When you fry a piece of lichen under in the ghee or in the oil, it releases the aroma. Then it gives a very good flavor to the food. So like that, lichens are also used in the perfume industry. As I told you, it doesn't give any smell, but it is a process in which it gives a smell. For example, in Kannauj in Uttar Pradesh, it is called as the perfume city. So where the lot of lichens are used for making the perfume. What they do, they put lichens along with the, put water, lichens and water, they boil it. They collect the vapors in this pipe like here, and they pass this vapor in a small container having essential already. This essential already, essential oil in the container, maybe sandalwood oil or it may be rose oil or whatever. But when the vapor from the lichen boiling thing goes into this essential oil, it gives completely different kind of smell. It is called as mehndi smell or the sundi smell, that is soil smell. So then this perfume is sold at the higher cost, maybe some 1,000 to 5,000 rupees per 5 ml only. Such an expensive perfume it becomes finally. So lichens are used as a dye. You know, this litmus paper which you use for acid base indicator, this is made from the lichens only. Nowadays synthetic litmus paper are there, or this one you have pH meter, but otherwise the lichens are one of the ingredient for the litmus paper, where they extract the lichen dye from the lichen and infuse it on the paper. Sometimes the textiles like woolen and the silk textile can also be dyed with the lichens, either treating the lichens with the ammonia or with the boiling with the water. So based on the species of lichens and duration of your treatment, it gives a beautiful color to the silk and the wool, sometimes to the cotton also. So we did small experiment in our institute. We collected different species of lichens and we tried to extract the dye and give a color to the tussar silk. You can see different lichen species and the beautiful color. Lichens are also sometimes used in the aesthetics. People wear it during the traditional festivals and all. Maybe this lady is wearing the lichen here, whereas this fellow is putting the lichen. He is not a tribal guy. He is simply making fun. This guy also wearing the lichen as a beard and all. This lady is wearing on her neck. This is the lichen bryoria she is wearing, whereas this is the lichen asthnia here. And you can make a lot of artifacts using the lichens. If you are living in a temperate place, colder area, you can use lichen in your garden also. And one of the important roles of the lichen is the bioindicator. They indicate air pollution. They also indicate mineral resources in the place. If a place is having the lot of minerals, for example, copper, lichens look bluish in the color. There are only few examples. Based on the lichen presence or absence, you can tell the health of the forest, ecological continuity, vegetation type and all. Especially in the air pollution, what happens? If the lichen is growing in an polluted area, it bleaches, it changes its color, and it starts peeling off from the substratum. If you have a close observation, you can see the sensitive species are disappearing. And you can also observe the loss of diversity, change in the community structure you can see. And moreover, the lichens have an ability to accumulate pollutant in them. Okay, so there are like they have there are all the not all the lichens are pollution sensitive. There are some lichens which are pollution tolerant also. These pollution tolerant ones, especially, they accumulate lot of pollutants in them. Such a lichens are brought to the laboratory and studied for their heavy metal accumulation. So I have just few slides, and I will take another 2-3 minutes, maximum 5 minutes to complete. So why these lichens are very sensitive to air pollution? Because they have very less portion of algae and maximum portion of fungus. And the algae are sensitive. Algae has chlorophyll content at center, and chlorophyll has few, I mean, these Fe, iron molecule at the center. And because of the pollutants, it gets replaced by the magnesium ion, and chlorophyll changes to pheophytin. Pheophytin, ability of pheophytin to photosynthesize reduces. Finally, that is how it went on here. So that is one thing. And lichens have do not have root system. They have small root kind of structures. That is for only for anchoring. They don't absorb the moist nutrients. So that is why lichen has to depend on the atmosphere for their nutrition. So lichens do not have any protective layer. It's hygroscopic in nature. So based on these all these characters, lichens become very sensitive to air pollution. Okay, so this is one simple study. I'll just take a call. Hello, Sajram, bolo. Bolo. तुम घर पहुंचो घंटी बजाओ उधर घर में मैडम है तो जो है बताए सॉरी सो दिस आई विल स्किप यूजुअली इन अ पोल्यूशन सेंटर देयर विल बी नो लाइकेंस एंड एज यू गो अवे फ्रॉम द सोर्स ऑफ पोल्यूशन दैट मे बी ऑटोमोबाइल इन एरिया सिटी सेंटर वेर द ऑटोमोबाइल एक्टिविटीज मोर or towards the or it may be industry which causing lot of pollution. So, but if you go away from the polluted area, you will start getting the lichens. That is how using this data you can make a nice zone mapping. So I'll skip this. And this is one study conducted in the Italy. It's still it's valid, and for the first time, good relation between the air pollution and the lichen diversity is shown. So, and also it is very much linked with the mortality due to the lung cancer, that is in turn due to the air pollution. Greener portion, what you see, there are high density diversity of lichen is there. Towards the bottom, where there are the red color is there, there are no lichens, or the lichens are not there, or the diversity is very reduced. So it very clearly correlated with the mortality due to the lung disease. You can see where the green portion there are no mortality, whereas in the red portion, there is a huge mortality due to the lung cancer. That is in turn due to the air pollution. So lichens are again found in the used in the medicine. The clues are found in the mummies. One mummy which is excavated from the Egypt and taken to Canada, when they opened it, they found lots of lichens here in that. And then they started speculating why the people used lichens. One of the possibility that lichens, they have medicinal property, the antimicrobial property it has helped in keeping the mummy in a good condition, even avoiding the decaying and the bad smell. So that is why the lichens are used. And lichens are used in the traditional medicine throughout the world. The great philosophers and all, they have documented it. And even in our Indian literature, maybe Rig Veda, Atharva Veda and all, people have used, there is a documentation, there is a mention of lichens being used in the medicine, in the Nigantus, Dhanvantri Nigantus and the Ayurveda and all. So in Ayurveda, it is used for several purposes, even for the headache, stomach pain, leprosy, many things are there. And in Yunani and homeopathy is also lichens are used. And Chinese medicine, lichens are one of the important ingredients. And this fellow, you know, Acharya Balakrishnaji, he had written a very nice article in Hindi regarding the uses of lichens. He claims that it can be used for the gray hair, headache, eye disease, and many things. You can use this link and check this. These are some of the lichens used in the for the medicines. Why lichens are medicinally important? Because they produce more than 1000 secondary metabolites. Most of them are unique to lichens. Only 50 or 60 found in the other group of organisms. Otherwise, these are very much unique to the lichens, and these are the secondary metabolites which are useful in the as the medicines. Okay, they play an important role as a medicines. It can be biological activities, maybe antimicrobial, antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, anti-cancer. Even people have studied for the liver disorder, that is hepatoprotective, and even for the cardio activities, cardiovascular diseases, diabetes also. So extract or the purified compound from the lichens have shown a lot of activities. So this is all the importance of the lichens. Lichens, although they are the small creatures in the nature, but they have a very good role. But unfortunately, their ecosystem services are not quantified. Other thing is that although lichens are medicinally important, still we don't have any good product out of lichens in a pharmaceutical industry. So that is because lichens are not available in the large quantity, because any bioprospecting work you do, you require large amount of lichens, at least at least till the stage when you identify a biologically active molecule. That time, till that stage, at least you require a huge quantity of lichens, but in lichens it is not available. And it's very difficult to culture lichens. You cannot cultivate the lichens in the gardens, and you cannot culture them. It's very slow growing, and finally at the end you will lose the patience while doing it. But still people are trying to find other ways for the utilizing these lichens for the benefit of the mankind. Okay, thank you. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Let me see the chat box.
Thank you so much, sir. We have few questions. I'll just show it to you, so it will appear on your screen.
Okay. Should I stop sharing my side?
No, sir. It's anyway. It's there. Not a problem. Sure. Bharat is asking a question.
Okay.
Is trading of lichens accounted as part of forest goods?
Yes, it is not all the places. But some places it is very much documented. For example, in Karnataka, if you go to BR Hillside and many other places, there are something called as lamp societies. Okay. These lamp societies, they have documented the lichen trade. The people collect the lichens from the forest area and give it to these societies, or they are kind of NGOs, they are kind of a mediator. They give it to them, they submit it there, and then it is documented, and they are paid for that. And some places, lichens are not, for example, in Uttarakhand, other things, lichen trade is not very well documented. So that is why illegal trade in the lichens is going on everywhere in most of the places, and most that is also because people are not aware regarding the importance of the lichens. They're simply treated as the forest waste or something like that. Sometimes it is even being exported outside as a packing material or something like that. So along with the moss, it goes out. So these are some of the things which are beyond the control of the common man. Why I say like this? Sometimes even the foresters and all know about this. They are helpless, and the common man is completely, he's not aware of these things. Okay. Anything else? Thank you. Do you see wide range of speciation among the species? recorded from Deccan Plateau to the Himalayan region? If so, what are their striking characters? Do you see wide range of speciation among species? Yes, there is a wide range of speciation starting from the Deccan Plateau to Himalayas. Exactly. I can generally answer this. I cannot answer very specifically. What happens if you see the Deccan Plateaus are the southern India or the Western Ghats and go towards the Himalayas. One clear-cut difference what you see here is the in the southern India, Deccan Plateau, these Custos lichens are more in diversity. Okay, they are very small in size. Sometimes they are very difficult to even observe in the field also. But if you see, go to the temperate place like Himalayas and all, especially Western Himalayas, you will get lots of folios and fruticos lichens. Okay, so this is one striking difference what you see here. And the diversity is more in tropical forest areas, and the luxuriant growth is more in the temperate and the alpine areas. So you can see the dense growth, abundant growth in the Himalayas. So where you will see lot of diversity in the southern India. Okay, this is another striking feature you can clearly see. Okay, then if you go to about species level, genus level, again, tropical areas have lots of Pyrenocarpus lichens, Graphitaceous species, like that. I can give more, a few more examples like that. Okay. So, do you see wide range of species among the species recorded? Okay, next question. Sir, as you told, lichens accumulate pollution. Can we grow such species in the cities and control the pollution? This is not possible. Because the lichens are very sensitive to microclimatic conditions. They require a certain microclimatic conditions for their growth. And if you are living in a temperate place, for example, you are living in a Bangalore city, for example, let us see, you can bring the lichens from the nearby area of Bangalore and try to grow them in the city area. That is possible. But if you think that you will bring a lichen from the Western Ghats and try to put them in the city area and try to grow, it is not possible because the climatic condition is completely different. Second thing is that lichens are very, very slow growing. Okay. So, you cannot expect the lichens to, and you will not also get the huge quantity, the quantity that is required for your experiment, that also will not get. So because of their quantity, because of their sensitivity to microclimatic condition, because of their slow growth, so it is not advisable to put them in the for the pollution control for the purpose. So it is not helpful. Okay, next. Next question.
Do lichens face any threats?
So threat is a broad term. So if I say conservation point of view, lichens, yeah, they face threat. Because you see these, as I told you, they are collecting a large quantity for a spice, for the perfume purpose and all. So this is called as the selective removal of lichens, because they don't collect all the lichens. They selectively remove the lichens. They target some species and all. So since it is a uncontrolled harvest, so the lichens are facing the threat of diversity loss. This is one thing. Second thing is that they are sensitive to climatic conditions and also air pollution. Now as the climate changes, there is a possibility that the sensitive species can migrate to the higher altitude places and finally vanish. And also due to the air pollution, there is a possibility that these lichens can be vanished. So this is also possible. So in this way, lichens they face a lot of threats. Can we make lichen through biotechnological means? Yes, you can make lichens through biotechnological means. There was a scientist called as Ahmadiyyan. So he did lot of experiment regarding the culture of lichens, and he created artificial lichens. In the sense, in a given lichen species, there will be a particular lichen, particular fungal species, as well as there will be a particular algal species. Species there that should be compatible. Then only it make a thallus. Then only it is called particular species of lichen. So, but he isolated fungus from other lichen, isolated algae from some other lichen, and then he brought them together and he successfully made a lichen. So by culturing these lichen mycobionts and photobionts, symbionts separately, bringing them together, you can expect lichen to be formed. Again, the question is that why you are making it. So if you have a purely academic reasons, then okay. Otherwise, if we have any academic questions, in the sense you are trying to see what is the relation between these two organisms, how they transfer the nutrients or the minerals or the other, how these two organisms communicate, these are okay, fine. But otherwise, it is a very, very slow experiment. Takes a lot of many months to years together. If you're taken up this subject for your PhD, there is no guarantee that you will finish your PhD in 3 years or so, 4 years, 5 years. There is a failure of success is, failure of your experiment is more here. So that is why your question should be clear why you are doing it. Okay. Next question. Sir, is there any secondary metabolites exploited at the industrial scale as of now in India? No. In India, secondary metabolites from the lichens are not in industrial scale, but China, they have even Chinese are clever people. So now arsenic acid is the one popular secondary metabolites that is isolated from the lichen containing arsenic acid from the several lichens including arsenia and all. So if you see in the Amazon, Alibaba, Flipkart and all, you just see arsenic acid. So they supply the lichen powder, the lichen arsenia powder, they will send you as a source of arsenic acid. This is one thing. Second thing is that Sigma sells these arsenic acid as a chemical in their catalog. You can see divaricatic acid. They are like the 2-3 acids extracted from the lichen, they sell it. So arsenic acid also used in some of the commercial product also. Such products are not available in India, like sunscreen lotions and all. So at India, lichen metabolites are not exploited. So there is scope, but that is the problem. You will not get biomass, but otherwise you can cultivate the fungal part of the lichen. Okay, they can culture the fungal part, that is easy to grow. You can make it produce the same metabolites as in the case of original thallus. So that is possible. Okay. Next.
Yeah. Are there any more questions from the participants?
I'll take one more call because it's the evening time. There are some important calls. Hello, tell me.
Are there any more questions from the participants?
Diti.
Yes, Sensei.
Yeah, you can hand over now. Wind up now.
Okay. So we don't have any more questions. So we'll wind up the session. I would like to thank Dr. Sanjeevan Ayaka, sir, for giving this wonderful talk on lichens and their importance. And we learned many aspects of lichens from its different prospects also, and the different species that have been recorded in India, and what are its importance and uses. So I hope all the participants have been benefited by this webinar talk. And thank you so much, sir.
For this NVS webinar. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So all the organizers of webinar, and also Dr. TVR, thank you very much.